and I went on pilgrimage to the Holy Land a couple of years ago, one of the things that I was really looking forward to doing was walking a piece of road that's in the Wadi Kelt. And the attraction of this road, if anybody's been there, seen it, done it, maybe, the attraction of it is that it is part of the original Jerusalem to Jericho road. And it is one of the areas where if you walk in the Wadi Kelt, you know that you are walking where Jesus walked. And sadly, very sadly, we weren't able to do it because the time that we were there, although it was September time, it was unseasonably hot. And in the Wadi Kelt, it was going to be 40 degrees C, and it's desert and it's arid, and the pilgrimage company that we were with said, you cannot do it because it is too dangerous. It is simply too hot. And if you do it, I can't remember how long the walk would have taken. It was only a little bit of stretch of road, an hour and a half or something. And the danger of dehydration and sunstroke was just too high. So that tells you something about that stretch of road. And it's a road that in its entire length is about 18 miles long. And you go down and down and down and down. And if you are walking from Jerusalem to Jericho, you descend the equivalent of Helvellyn, if you know how high Helvellyn is, about 3,000 feet, some odd. So you go down a long way. That tells you how high Jerusalem is, but it also tells you how low Jericho is, down at the kind of level of the Dead Sea. And at the time of Jesus, it was a major thoroughfare. It was for trading caravans, for military personnel. I don't know how they got along it, because the bit that we went and looked at the bit that we would have walked, and it was like a footpath. And the pilgrims who visited Jerusalem three times a year would have travelled that road. It's isolated, barren rock, desert, hot, lots of hiding places. The perfect place if you are a bandit to hide and jump out on unsuspecting people. And then lots of escape routes into the desert and then run away again. And anybody left, beaten up on that road and left, given the circumstances I've just described to you, would not die from their injuries. They would die from the sun, because of the exposure and the lack of water and the no shelter. So that tells you something about that road. And so when Jesus said a man was walking from Jerusalem to Jericho, in their minds they would have been going, oh, that's a dangerous road, I wouldn't do that on my own. They would have known the folly of going on their own, the dangers such a journey would have. And probably in the story that Jesus then told, because of their view of the Samaritans, they might well have expected that the Samaritan was going to be the bandit. And of course you know the story, and you know that that's not quite how it worked out. I am going to read the story, because you probably know what I'm talking about already, but we're not going to look at the story from a usual angle. All right. Oh, Rosemary's trying to be invisible. you'll now be invisible on YouTube, Rosemary. So I'm reading from Luke chapter 10. She's being invisible again, can you see? Luke chapter 10. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law, he replied. How do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and when he fell into the hands of robbers, they stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he travelled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." And Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." You know the story. A couple of weeks ago, it was the church I go to in Tunbridge Wells, it was our church weekend. And I missed it because we had an event on here. And when I saw the vicar the next time, I said to him, "How did the church weekend go?" Because the church weekend was a little bit different this year. It was a kind of a do-it-yourself thing, and they were going to be looking at how the church was being church and how the church was being church in the community. And there are changes happening within the parishes there, and the parishes are being kind of redesigned, as it were. And so there's a lot of new stuff happening. And he said, we ended up talking about the Good Samaritan and how all the focus is always on the man that's beaten up, and we admire the Good Samaritan and we tut at the priest and the Levites, and you know. And he said, and then he said, but no one ever says, what are we going to do about the Jericho Road? What are we going to do about the Jericho Road? And in the context of the church weekend, that was about the community of the church, and it's in quite a poor area of Tunbridge Wells. And so it has great relevance. But it set me thinking. And the thought has not left me over the last couple of weeks. I've been turning this over in my mind and thinking, do you know, I think we all have our own Jericho Roads. All of us. We have our personal Jericho Roads. I don't doubt that we all have one. Some of us may have more than one, if we are honest with ourselves. So what do I mean by our own personal Jericho Road? Well, maybe, could be all sorts of things, but patterns of behaviour that maybe start off in one place and end up somewhere else. And where you end up is that place where you end up beating yourself up big time because of something you've said, something you've done, you've lost control over something, you've become angry maybe, and you spend ages black and blue because you've told yourself before you're never going to end up there again, and yet here you are on the Jericho Road, black and blue, and thinking, will I never learn? And when I was thinking back over kind of So what Jericho Roads have I had? I remembered when I was a child old enough to have pocket money and a child old enough to be able to go across the road where we were living on my own and to spend my pocket money without, guidance. And I would tell myself as I was going across the road that I wasn't going to spend all my money at once, and I was only going to buy 2 packets of crisps and maybe a bar of chocolate, and then when I got home, I wasn't going to eat them all at once. Guess what? I would get home and I'd have one of the packets of crisps, and then I would think, I'll have a bit of chocolate. And then I'll have a bit more, and then a bit more. And you know, that packet of crisps is burning a hole in my appetite. And before I knew it, I'd eaten a whole lot. And then I would go through this pattern of, why did I do that? Why, well, you know, even at that age, why did I do that? Why did I spend all my money at once when I said I wasn't going to? Why did I buy all those things instead of something a bit more worthwhile? And then why did I eat it all at once? And so now I haven't got any money left. I'm feeling a bit sick. And and so you know what I mean. And I'm sure that you can, and actually that's still a bit of a Jericho road for me, you know, I'm not going to have cake. Lovely as the cake is, Ian. They're listening in the kitchen. I'm not going to have cake. I'm not going to have cake. And then, you know what? There's a bit in my hand.
And then it's a little clean bit.
Well, hopefully not. Hopefully not. But there are other Jericho roads, ones that are not so easy to laugh at. We even say something in our language sometimes, don't we, in conversation. You know, we have that that conversation with somebody and you begin to get in an area that's a little bit touchy, and then one of you will say, don't go down that road. And you know what that means? That if you continue that conversation, it's either going to get to the point where you fall out, or somebody gets really cross, or they say something they're going to regret. So we all have that sense of, we know the roads that lead to danger. I remember a story that Adrian Plass told in one of his books, and I can't remember at this point whether he was telling the story of himself or whether he was telling a kind of a parable story, but it was a story of a man who was a commuter, and he got the same train, same time, every day, and he stood like commuters do at the same spot on the platform because he knew where the carriage door would open, and he would get in and he would see the same people. And over the course of time, there was a lady that, you know, they'd kind of nod to and wave at. And it got to the point over the course of time where they started to save a seat for one another and sit next to one another. And then they got to know one another. And eventually the man realised that this was getting a bit dangerous. He'd got wife at home, and there was this friendship that was developing that was perhaps rather more than it ought to be. And he was very brave, and he went home and he said to his wife, do you know, I've got something to tell you. I think I might be getting into a problem that is a bit too deep for me. And he explained what it was. And do you know what she said? Catch a different train. If the 8:20 is a Jericho road for you, get the 8 o'clock or the 8:30. And that is so true, isn't it? It's about recognising where the Jericho road begins and then choosing not to take the first step. And I know that is so hard. But some of our patterns of behaviour are less easy to spot, aren't they? And we suddenly find that we're hurtling downhill at a descent that is too quick for us to stop, and we plunge headlong into those problem areas. And then when we're there, as I said earlier, we beat ourselves up and we tell ourselves off, and we say that we're useless and we're not worth it and we can't do it, and all the other things that we tell ourselves. And like the man on the Jericho road, we need a good Samaritan. You said it. We have one. It's Jesus. And you know, as I was pondering this, I was thinking about it again on my way in as I was driving in this morning. I had this sense that Jesus stands on the dangerous corner. I don't know if you've ever seen that play. Really good play. But anyway, I won't go off down that tangent. He stands on that dangerous corner and says, kind of, go by, go by, you know, go by. Oh, she's done it, she's off. And then he races off down to the next kind of stopping point. Stop, and we go by. And then when we get to the place where we're really in trouble, he's going, Suzanne, look at me, look at me. Suzanne, look at me, look at me, look at me. And we're going, look at me, Suzanne, look at me. And we ignore him. And then when we're beaten up, then he comes and binds us up and says, come on, up you get. Let's go to a place of safety. Let me teach you a new way. And how we need to learn the new way. Because he loves us. So Jericho Road. How tempting. How dangerous. But Jesus is our good Samaritan.